Hello and welcome back to the channel, and we're going to take a look at some more 1970s British sex comedy because I find it fascinating how terrible they are, yet apparently how popular they were at the time. So this is 1975's Confessions of a Window Cleaner. Now, the Confessions series was the probably more famous series in comparison to the Adventures of, with Robin Asquith as the lead guy here. This came out in 1975, this particular one, which for a British film making was the same year as Monty Python, Tommy, Barry Lyndon, The Man Who Would Be King, and the Rocky Horror Picture Show. So it was a mixed year. As you can see, we're picking up pretty much from the end of the previous installment, which was Confessions of a Window Cleaner. So our lead, Timmy, getting into all sorts of humorous sexual scrapes. It's actually based on a book, which was something that was really surprising to me. And I did a bit of research there, and it turns out that Timothy Lee is a pen name for Christopher Wood, who wrote a series of these confessions novels because he could knock them out in 5 weeks and they would sell. He's probably more well known these days for having screenwriter credit on The Spy Who Loved Me and Moonraker, two of the more diversive Bonds, that's how he's saying. Anyway, we pick up with Timothy and his brother-in-law in this odd club slash pub where they've been listening to a band, and they just randomly say, "Oh, we'll manage you, let's sign a contract," and they just become the managers of this band completely at random. Now, the lead character of Timmy is just so bizarre. He's pictured as this really klutzy, idiotic, doofus character, but apparently he's completely sexually irresistible to women, because basically all women he meets that he isn't related to immediately seem to want to have sex with him. It's very odd. It is like, if you remember, Some Mothers Do Have Them, it's like if Some Mothers Do Have Them lead character was a sex god. It's very odd. Anyway, we had a sort of brief bit there with the family, who are all pretty much fairly unlikable. Anyway, Timmy goes to see this lady who we saw in the earlier sequence that his brother-in-law was sleeping with, and she's married to a record producer, or at least a record company executive. So they're trying to use their connection there to get an in for their band. And of course, we get a classic sequence in these films of the husband coming home and being suspicious, and Timmy has to quickly get dressed and hide to try and escape, whilst the wife plays it innocent. It does seem in 70s Britain, nobody behaved themselves in their marriages. And then, of course, some classic humour here as the brother-in-law character is talking to the record executive whilst he is busy, shall we say, in the background, having put the phone receiver down. Anyway, the two guys go to meet the band, who for some reason are parked up on a housing estate in a van. The lead guy in the band appears to be about 40. I don't know whether pop stars were just generally older in the 70s, but that is very odd. Also, a classic mother figure comes looking for her daughter, thinking that her daughter is absconded with these pop performers, as everybody keeps calling them. And of course, the daughter is in the back of the van and runs off as they make her quick getaway. 70s Britain just looked so dour, didn't it? Concrete, greys everywhere. Everybody meets this lady, who is a reporter on a local newspaper, and she, for reasons unexplained, immediately takes an interest in them and in this band that nobody has ever heard of. So we cut to the scene in the newspaper's office. And of course, Timmy, being the klutz that he is, manages to start a fire with a cigarette in a bin. He runs around trying to put it out with a fire extinguisher. Tea, meanwhile, has just kind of poured water on it. I don't know why he just immediately attacks that wall. For there's no reason for him to do that. It's just so bizarre. I find all of these films so bizarre. Of course, there are people canoodling in the dark room because haha. And then, you know, this gets sprayed everywhere because the foam looks like certain other white substances that might come spraying out. Anyway, the family have helped stitch some shirts for the band together, and they arrange to get a crowd of, what they initially think is going to be young girls to mop the band, but through apparently humorous confusion, it turns out to be a bunch of women from an old ladies' home. So we have some classic, oh, me hearing trumpet humor going on there. And just in terms of the writing, I have no idea why they've arranged for this mob, because nobody else is there to witness the mob as they come to play this town hall on the middle afternoon. There's another act. The name of the act is basically the entire joke and the entire reason why the act exists. We get to see the band playing, and we do get the full songs. And this film actually did have a full soundtrack album featuring these songs. Now, in terms of the film, the songs, I guess, aren't terrible, but they're very much just padding out the runtime by playing a whole performance of a song here. Eventually, things build up. Crowd gets very excited. It becomes a bit of a mini riot. The lead singer starts sort of banging his head on the piano, which explodes for some unknown reason. Timmy runs off into a side storage room. Of course, he's followed by a young woman who, for some reason, thinks he's Mick Jagger making a comeback. Now, in 1975, had Mick Jagger disappeared from the scene? Again, it's an odd moment. Then we get the police, who have a secret passionate love affair they're about to embark on, of course, in the same room as Timmy and this girl. Now, plot-wise, I would say overall this is stronger than the Adventures Of series that we've looked at, because there is actually kind of a plot here rather than just a random collection of scenes. It's not the greatest plot in the world and it's a bit weak, but there is a plot here, which is quite nice for these sex comedy films, it seems. So we pad the film out a bit more by having a sequence of them recording some songs, and then the guys head to the party held by a... I think he's a presenter on a music show, and that's why they're there. Again, Timmy gets himself caught up into a comedic sexual situation. This time it's with this lady who's doing it in the party through like a one or two-way mirror, so everybody's watching them. And then Timmy comes out and is like, "What are you looking at?" And they're like, "You, oh, you're funny." Again, much like these other films we've looked at, it's not sexy at all. It's very seaside postcard humor kind of smut, rather than anything that's generally actually sexy, if you know what I mean. So they hatch a plan to buy records themselves to drive the band up the charts. Of course, the girl working in the record shop immediately wants to have sex with Timmy, having met him 30 seconds ago. Here's the talent show. The big joke here is that it's called Star Knockers, because knockers is a word potentially for breasts. They have like a clapometer, so the brother-in-law decides to hit the fire alarm when it's time to make noise to, you know, get the biggest possible reaction, which causes everything to explode, because of course it does. We then have this really odd sequence with the birthday party for the baby, and it just makes everybody in this family just look horrible, apart from maybe the baby's mum, because everybody's like, "Oh, I've not bought the baby anything. He can have this bottle of booze I've pulled out of my coat pocket." It's just so odd, and it doesn't drive the film forward in any way. I don't think anybody went to see this because they were attached to the family of the central character. Anyway, somehow the band have got onto a sort of royal variety performance. So we have, you know, hints of the Queen. Timmy has got into scrapes backstage, of course, but in the end they managed to have a successful performance. But then eventually, once the performance is done, all the various characters start to fight with each other over various things, just as the record producer is getting excited. And of course the curtain comes back for the encore, and Timmy is thrown out of the band, and that's where we end. Now, it's not as bad as the other films that are similar that we've looked at, the sort of Avengers series, but it's still not good. Titan Sound rated it the worst film, British film, of 1975, and that's not surprising. Now, another two films in the series got made after this over the next couple of years, and yeah, these are just so odd, these films. I just don't understand why they were so popular, because they're not funny, they're not sexy, and they're just painful to watch. But I guess things with nudity in were popular when, you know, porn wasn't so easy to get hold of. I guess that must be the ride they did so well. But anyway, yeah, that was Confessions of a Pop Performer. Like they are the similar films, I wouldn't recommend watching it unless you really are curious. But I think for me, that's going to be enough of these 70s sex comedies. I don't think I can take any more of them. But we'll be back soon with some more reviews. We'll see you then.